हेलो एवरीवन, वेलकम टू इंग्लिश शॉर्ट एंड क्लासेस एक्सरसाइज 23। गेट रेडी फॉर द डिक्टेशन। डिक्टेशन विल बी स्टार्ट इन 5 सेकेंड। स्टार्ट। आई एम ट्रूली डिलाइटेड टू बी हेयर एट दिस वेरी स्पेशल ओकेजन। वी आर हेयर टू रिकॉग्नाइज द गुड वर्क ऑफ गुड जर्नलिस्ट्स एंड ऑल्सो टू पे tribute to the memory of a great publisher. I was unable to join the Indian Express family at the Ramnath Goenka centenary celebrations in 2004. I therefore take this opportunity to pay tribute to Ramnath ji's memory. He built this great institution of the Indian Express with passion and dedication. As my friend has written in his biography of Ramnath ji, he was a man of many parts, a freedom fighter, a Gandhian worker, a politician, a merchant, a real estate developer and industrialist, a newspaper magnate, and above all, a patriotic Indian. Few publishers have defended the freedom of the press with as much passion and conviction as he did. Therefore, I am personally very pleased that the Express Group has instituted these awards for excellence in journalism in Ramnath ji's memory. It is a fitting tribute to a man who greatly valued professional excellence in journalism. Some time back, speaking at the Chandigarh Press Club, I had expressed my concerns about the rapid quantitative growth of our media outpacing qualitative development. The pressures of competition have hobbled professionalism and encouraged some unhealthy trends. I was heartened, however, by the reaction of many media professionals to my observations. I was happy to see many turn their torch inward and introspect. The Editors Guild of India responded in a most professional manner. I hope the debate within media about trends in media has helped strengthen the hands of journalists who are proud of their professionalism. I am sure the Ramnath Goenka Awards will further encourage the growth of a professional approach to journalism. India is fortunate to have a free and vibrant media. We must defend its freedom and foster its vibrancy. As I have said before, freedom of press is more than just the freedom of publishers and editors. It is the freedom of society to have its voice heard. The exercise of this freedom does require, as your motto proclaims, a journalism of courage. However, it also requires a journalism of honesty and integrity, a journalism of toil and hard work. I also believe that a journalism of courage is not just about giving voice to those who are willing to shout, but it is about giving voice to the voiceless and to those who choose to be silent. I have heard my friend Arun Shori, a distinguished editor of the Indian Express and a compatriot of Ramnathji, decry a trend in journalism where every discussion is turned into a debate. Perhaps that is because debates are entertaining and discussions are boring. But there is a downside to this trend. A discussion can facilitate a consensus. A debate invariably divides opinion. There are many issues of great public and national interest where a debate is useful but where a consensus is necessary. Getting rivals to disagree and turn debate into a big sport may be entertaining and commercially rewarding, but does it help society move forward? Our democracy may be better off if we can increase the area of agreement rather than sharpen disagreements. I would like you to reflect on these issues. Our polity has come to terms with coalition governments. Political parties of varying hues and diverse constituencies are trying to work together in complex coalitions. For a country to move forward, any government has to ensure consensus on many issues across a wide spectrum of political opinion. The national media has an important role to play in the process of consensus building. If media is content with focusing only on disagreements, who will widen the area of agreement? In free societies, there are bound to be extreme positions taken on many issues. But a great majority of people normally occupy a consensual middle ground. To say that there are opposing views on an issue is not enough. More often than not, the majority view is a middle view. Those who articulate extreme views tend to be vocal. Their voice is heard more often on television and in newspapers. All of this is perhaps more entertaining. Mass media may give greater expression to those who are vocal and articulate, but it is the electoral process that reflects the will of the silent majority. No democratically elected government can ignore the interests of the silent majority. We often say that we are a plural society and that our nationhood is a celebration of unity in diversity. But we do not always remember that this unity has been made possible by our ability to arrive at a consensual common ground on most policy issues. If every viewpoint insists that it reflects the truth, then diversity will manifest itself in disarray, in a social and political impasse. How then is unity possible? Our democracy was not built on the simple principle of the rule of the majority. It was, I believe, built on the idea of unity in diversity. That is the most important idea that Gandhiji and Panditji gave the people.